Hi, and welcome to Refactoring Example. This is with CMPUT301. And these slides were originally by Ken Wong. Alright, so we're going to show a refactoring example. Basically, we're going to work on a program that calculates and prints a statement of a customer's charge at a video store. Video stores are kind of like archaic libraries that don't really exist anymore. You used to go to the video store to rent movies rather than going online. So you'd actually walk around in aisles and you'd pick up movies, and then it'd act a lot like the public library, where you take the movie out and then you'd watch it and then you have to return it. You'd only get the movie for a certain number of days. Also, because they like customers, they tried to enroll people into plans and into kind of customer loyalty plans whereby you'd gain points and things like that. So we're going to model a movie store, which is kind of an exercise in kind of business archaeology. And this is a movie store where people can rent movies. The movies have different prices. The movies are rented for a number of days, and the customers can collect frequent renter points. So what kind of design are we going to have? Well, let's see. We got customers. We got movies. We got prices. We got days and points. Right? Rented. Right. Rented is a bit of a concern. So we got customer here. We have the customers gets a statement. We'll make a rental because we can have a customer rent out more than one movie. Customers will have many rentals. Rentals will have one specific movie, but a movie will be related to many rentals. And we'll just basically get the number of days the movie was rented. So we'll keep it relatively simple. Rentals are only for one movie. So let's start off. Movies. Movies will have type codes. So we have children's movies, regular movies, new releases. Typically children's movies are cheaper. Also heavily abused because they get peanut butter in the tapes and everything. Yeah, a lot of video stores used to actually be VHS cassettes and beta and stuff like that. Other archaic technologies. Not really a lot around anymore. Anyways, so we've also got a title for our movie, a price code, which will be one of these. So we can make a new movie with a title or a price code. Notice how these are static. We can get the price code, set the price code, get the title. Our rental will have a movie and have days rented. So we got a movie, number of days rented, we return those things. This style is an old Java style that was to indicate that things were private. It's now popular in Python to indicate you shouldn't mess with these variables, they're private to that class. The customer has a name and rentals, and the rentals are done as a vector. A vector is basically a synchronized array list, and this is done in old Java style where we don't declare that this is a vector of rentals. But it will be a vector of rentals. Our customer, we initialize with a name, and we can add a rental to it at any time. To make a statement, what we can do is we've got a total amount of cash and the total number of frequent rental points, and we'll enumerate all the rentals. We'll basically go through a loop of them. We'll start with a result that will build up. Basically, we'll say a rental record for the customer's name, because this we're still in customer, right? We're still in customer. And then for each rental, we're going to basically set up this amount to store the cost, right? And so we'll get our rental. So this is the old style of dealing with an iterator. We got enumeration, it has elements, we get the next element, and then we get the movie's price code, and based on the movie type, if it's regular, it costs $2, and then for every day after 2 days that it's rented, right, we're going to multiply that by 1.5. And we're going to add that to this amount right there. And then if it's a new release, well, we'll go ahead and we will multiply that by the number of days rented times 3. And if it's a children's movie, it costs $1.50, but that's for 3 days. And then if it's over 3 days, we add more. Then at the bottom of remember, we're in statement. At the bottom of the statement, we say the amount owed is the string value of total amount, and total amount was the cost, and then plus the frequent renter points, right? You earn so many frequent renter points. And the frequent renter points were here. And I think we're missing the code for frequent renter points. Yeah, they're out of order. I think I moved it. Anyways, frequent renter points. For every movie, we increase it. And if it's a new release, we increase it one more. And basically, we show for each rental, we show the movie title in the string, and we do that. All right, so I'll just fix this right here. So to clarify, the rental has more elements. First, we do a price code, and then we... This should work now. So, first we deal with the price code, then we deal with the frequent renter points, and then we print the movie name, and this is for every rental. And then, at the bottom of the thing, we show the amount owed, and how many rental points we have, and then we return. Now, this closes the class, this closes the method. So let's just review that again. We got a customer, they got customer, add rental, get name, statement. Statement initializes total amount, frequent render points. We go for every rental. We look at the price code of the rental, get the cost, things like that. Get the frequent render points, update the frequent render points if it's new release. And then we print out the total at the bottom. So the general behavior is the customer, we ask the customer class for a statement, then it goes for all rentals. It gets the movie, gets the price code, gets days rented. So what smells here? Well, things that smell include as procedural. It's not really object-oriented. The statement method does too much, right? In fact, the customer class is a blob class. It'd be difficult to add new features to it. And look how it's using these other classes. It's just asking them for things. That's like data classes. It's not actually getting rental to do anything. The rental's not responsible for itself. The movie's not responsible for itself. So, we want to apply refactoring, and refactoring allows us to basically restructure code to add a feature, and we do it in small steps. But the most important part of refactoring is we need unit tests. So before you refactor, you run your unit tests, okay? So the general process of refactoring is basically run unit tests, right? Then you refactor. Then you run your unit tests, fix your refactoring, and tests as necessary. And then you keep repeating this until it works, right? So if it works, then basically you're done. Yay. Okay, so we're going to extract a method. The statement method was really huge. We're going to look for logical chunks of code in the statement method and extract them. So, first off, let's look at this price code stuff, right? So, all this price code stuff, this is a coherent chunk of code. It's even encapsulated by parentheses. We can move this out. What's a good name for this? Something like get amount, you know, something along those lines. Amount four, so we had total amount. So what we're going to do is we're going to put the rental in there, and we're going to say this is the amount the rental is worth, and that's amount four. So we're not going to move this class. We're just going to extract it immediately. We're going to extract the method, and we're going to make amount four. This code is going to go in amount four. But one thing you have to do is you have to look at the dependencies of this. It depends on each. So each was a rental. So we're going to have to put that in the parameter list. It also depends on this amount, but this amount was just zero right there. So maybe we can take this amount with us. So here's amount four. This is the extract method. Private double amount four, rental each, double this amount, and this amount right there. And then the rest of this stuff did not change at all, other than it's kind of poorly named. So what did we do? Well, we compile it, and we test it, and we see if it works. And it worked. So if it didn't work, then we have to fix it. Well, let's rename the variables in amount four, because they're kind of bad. So we got this amount, we got each day's rented, this amount. For each is a bad name. Rental or rental is probably a better name. Result is probably a better name for this amount, because that's the end result that we want to deal with. Now, look at the difference. So it's a little shorter, and it's also clear. It reads, for a rental, get days rented. You know, result plus two. Pretty easy. We compile and test, check if anything's unusual. No, it works. Then what we want to do is we realize amount four is not customer information. It's actually rental information. If we go and look at amount four, the rental, right? The rental doesn't care about the customer. There's no customer information here. It's all about the rental. So let's move it right to the rental class. So we're going to take it from customer, and then we're going to move it to rental, and we're going to rename it. We're going to change the get charge. What we have to do is we got to get rid of a rental. We could replace a rental with this, but we could also just get rid of this altogether. So not a lot of changes, right? But we've made the code a lot more readable. Look, this token goes away. These extra dot tokens go away, right? Becomes far more readable. So we moved this method into rental. Now rental is far more responsible for itself, which is excellent. Inside a customer, though, we're still calling amount four. So if we go back, right, we go back to customer, we can see that in customer, we call amount four. So we gotta change the code in amount four. So we'll delegate to the rental, right? Given the rental, we'll just get its charge. We compile, test, clean it up. So then we're going to replace amount four with get charge, just references. So this amount four, we're going to go each get charge, right? Compile and test, it works, great. What you should notice here is we still have this amount, and so what we're going to do is we're going to get rid of it. It's not really needed. So this amount, basically, we only use it once, right? We get the charge, we print it, and we add it. We don't manipulate it any further. Notice how it never changes other than from here to here, and that's not really important. This value is never used. So what we can do is we can replace this temporary variable with a query. And what a query is, it's a method that answers a question. And the question will be what the charge is. So we'll just say get charge and get charge. That way we don't need a temporary, and maybe it's a little slower, but so be it. So let's do the same thing with, after testing, let's do the same thing with frequent renter points. So here's the code that's left over for frequent renter points. We want to get rid of this. Who's responsible for frequent renter points? The rental. So let's get the frequent renter points from the rental. So we move basically all this code, plus plus and all this jazz, we move it to here. So if it's a new release and its days are rented greater than one, we return two. Otherwise, we return one, which is fundamentally the same logic as this, with less mutation. So this is 1 point and 2 point. So the else case is 1 point. We've got 2 points. So now we've moved this to rental, and now we have to delegate to rental. So each get frequent renter points. What we now want to do, right, each get frequent renter points, what we now want to do is we want to get rid of that total amount, right? Why do we have to keep this, right? We should replace it with something like get total charge. So what we can do is we can get rid of this get charge thing here, and we can replace it with code that, okay, look, this is here, it goes away, it's no longer there. This code here is a variable. It goes away, we just replace it with a method. So what do we have to do this? It means we have to go for every rental, we've got to add it up. Basically, this code has to be moved into a method. So inside the customer, we get total charge, and we'll go through all of our rentals, and we'll just add them up and return it. Now, this could be slower if we called this many times, and we're also iterating through it once already. But this way, we can always answer that query, get total charge. Now we're going to replace the temp with a query. We're going to eliminate get frequent render points by doing the same thing. We'll get total render points. So here's frequent render points, right? We're getting the frequent render points and adding them up. So what do? Well, we get rid of this, and we move this and some of this into a method. And that method will be called get frequent render points, or get total frequent render points. And that will be a query, and that will be a method here that just sums it up, keeps all logic to itself. This method doesn't do anything else other than calculate frequent render points. So let's look at what we had. We had a customer, they get days rented, they get price codes, movies, rentals. After the extract method, amount 4 was added, and then we moved the method to get charge. After we moved the method, we could get rid of it. And we extracted and moved the method for get frequent render points. Right? And then we replaced the temporal query. We got get total charge. We had to get total frequent render points. So now rental is far more responsible for itself. It answers get charges and get frequent render points. These two queries, they answer questions about the summation, the total. So this is our second structural design. So our behavior goes like this. You ask for the statement. You ask customer to get total charge for all rentals. You get the charges. Then the customer asks get total frequent render points, and for all rentals, get the charges. The consequence of this refactoring is the system is more object-oriented. It decomposes big methods into smaller ones, distributes responsibilities among classes. It's a little bit more code, it's easier to read, and there could be slower performance, unless the JVM is nice to us. But nonetheless, it's pretty interesting. But one thing you gotta remember is to run your tests every single time. This refactoring allows us to add new features. So we could change the output of the statement. We could switch it to HTML. And it would just require a little bit of code cloning, and bada bing, we're done. It's like the same code as before, but it's very short. So it'd be very trivial to add new features. Okay. So one of the big reasons why you do refactoring is your needs change. So one of the changing needs is price. So what if we get a new kind of movie? How do we deal with that? So, or if a movie changes, if a movie is no longer a new release, its behavior changes. It's not a new release anymore. So we got to deal with that. So what we want to do is we basically, we want to stop inspecting the rental logic. So if you go and look at our old, it was not the move method, it was get charge. Get charge inspects the movie. Shouldn't the movie be sort of responsible for this kind of stuff? Because it's not the rental, right? It's dependent on the movie, right? So maybe we can move that logic. So that's the goal. Okay. So let's just go back. So we want to basically make sure the rental logic doesn't depend on specific movie types. If we add a movie type, I shouldn't have to change the rental class. So what we're going to do is we're going to first move the method get charge from rental to movie. So we have to look here at what the dependencies are. So this depends on movie. This depends on the rental and once the day is rented. So we're going to have to put that in there somehow. So when we move this method, we'll probably add a parameter, days rented. Okay? So when we do that, we also have to go back and we have to have get charge be a delegation to the movie to get the charge and the days rented. And we do the same thing for frequent renter points. We still need days rented, so we're going to add that as a parameter, and we're going to move this off to movie. So we add a parameter, and we just replace it. So the code got a lot simpler, and we made the movie responsible for what render points it's worth. Then, back in rental, we have to basically keep everything going. We basically have to replace that method with the delegation. But now we're delegating to movie. Its behavior is being delegated. So, we've got conditional logic. We have those if statements about the type codes. Can we replace it with inheritance? So, maybe what we can do is we can have different kinds of movies. So, a regular movie knows what it is. A children's movie knows what it is. A new release movie knows what it is. But maybe there's a problem with this redesign. Is a movie always a new release movie? No. Eventually it doesn't become a new release movie. Eventually it becomes a regular movie. So should we destroy the new release movie and make it a regular movie, a clone of the new release movie? Maybe. But we want the movie to keep its identity. So what can we do? So a movie may change its classification during its lifetime, but an object cannot change its class during its lifetime. So what's the solution? Well, we can use conditional logic. Instead of the movie having a specific type, we could have the movie change some internal type. It could change its price. The price could be aware of certain things, like if it was a new movie or not. And the price could be aware of the different conditions. This is basically the state design pattern. We're going to delegate the behavior of price, basically the cost of the movie and the frequent render points, to a price object. So what we're going to do is we're going to have movie. And movie is going to have price. But price can be any kind of implementation. So when we call get charge, we're going to delegate to price. So this is movie, not rental. Movie is going to call price get charge. We're going to replace it like that. So that's what replacing conditional logic is. It's going to require us to make a bunch of classes, though. So we're going to replace a type code with state. And then we're going to basically compile and test after each step. And we're going to basically make sure uses of the price type code go through the accessor methods. So here's the here's a replace type code with state. We got the price code, right? What we're going to do is we're going to call set price code. We're adding set price code. We're just going to make sure we call it. Okay. So this allows us to do logic if necessary. So let's do refactoring. Let's add new state classes. So we're going to make an abstract class called price. And it's got price code. And then we're just going to have the regular price return movie.regular. And the new release price movie.newrelease, and the movie children's. Now, we're not doing a big change. We're still returning price code. And we're going to basically have the class return the price code. So we're going to delegate that. So we're going to replace the type code with instances of the price state class. So in terms of movie here, instead of these ints, what we're going to do is we're going to replace them with prices. So we're going to initialize with price. To get a price code, we'll delegate the price. It gets the price code. And then to set the price code, we'll basically do this pattern here. You should know what pattern this is. This is basically a kind of factory pattern. It's turning data into classes. Kind of factory method, because you could overload it. All right. So we're building the right movie based on the type, and we're setting the price accordingly. But you can still set the price code according to the price code that you're set with. Now what we want to do is we want to move that code. We want to move the get charge code from the movie to the price class. So this is pretty easy. We basically say movie price. Okay, so that's pretty good. We just moved it. Nothing really had to change. The problem is it still has this awful price code thing going on. And we still have to delegate to price. But at least now we got this behavior where the price is now responsible for the charge and the movie just delegates for it. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to replace that switch statement in price get charge, and we're going to use the inheritance to deal with it. So we got get charge. Remember, we had price be abstract. And what we're going to replace it with is basically multiple implementations. For a regular price movie, our get charge logic is here. So it's this block. Then we just do a return result, right? For new releases, it's going to be this logic here. And then we're going to return result. And then for children's movie, it's going to be this logic here and there. So one thing you should notice with conditions is oftentimes these blocks here, like this is a block, this is a block. So this here is a block, this is a block, this is a block. They become basically methods in other classes. And what's nice is the class is nice and short, right? All these classes will extend price. And then in price, we say we've got an abstract double get charge. Okay? So then, nothing really has to change, because what's going to happen is movie is still going to call price to get charge. And based upon what price is, the appropriate get charge method will be called. So now we're going to move a method. We're going to move get frequent render points to the price class. So in movie, we go ahead and move it. Pretty easy. And now in movie, we have to delegate. So we go price get frequent render points. And then we're going to replace the if statement inside of there. So one, we're going to have a default behavior and then a specialization. So in price, by default, you just return one. And if you specialize it, right, you just overload. And in this case, it just does the check and it returns two. This is a ternary operator. Based upon this expression, if it's true, it returns this. If it's false, it returns this. So it's now easy to change price behavior. We can add new prices if anything. And if the movie changes its classification, we just change its price object. And what's really nice is the rest of the application doesn't care or know about that state pattern, but the object's now changing behavior. So now our system is a lot more complicated, but way better. Basically, the customer has rentals. The rentals have movies, have one movie. And the movie will have a price code. And this price code can change. So it can be regular, children's, or new release. If we want to add a new price, we just add one here. It's pretty nice. So our third behavioral design, we now go deeper. To get total charge, it goes for all rentals, get the charge, get the charge, get the charge. For all frequent renter points, get the points, get the points. So it's a lot of delegation. Java might speed this up for you, but you never know. You might take a performance hit on this, but it is a much better design. Okay.